I think people generally view the ocean as being this thing that's out there that we don't necessarily interact with.
There is just so much potential underwater, and the activities we have in the ocean are just increasing.
Engineers putting together these biologically inspired robotic vehicles that's introducing people to the effects that humans have on the oceans.
Everyone, everywhere, is inextricably connected to and utterly dependent upon the existence of the sea. Deep below the surface of our ocean is an intricate bio-network that we all depend on, and one we must all work together to protect. Health to the ocean means health to us. Research at the University of Southampton is supporting the global effort to protect the blue heart of our planet. By working with international partners, researchers are gaining a deeper understanding of how this fragile ecosystem works and our past and future impact on them.
I think people generally view the ocean as being this thing that's out there that we don't necessarily interact with.
Stacey Felgate is a postgraduate research student based at the National Oceanography Centre in Southampton. She's been leading a land-ocean study looking at how deforestation in Belize is affecting the global carbon and nutrient cycles in the ocean.
Belize is one of the most forested nations in the world, but it's also undergoing deforestation and agricultural expansion really quickly. So it's really important that we understand what effect that's having on the water system, because when you cut down trees, a lot of the soil gets destabilized and pushed into the rivers. And also when you do agriculture, you add things to the land, and sometimes that will also get pushed into rivers. Belize also has the second largest coral reef in the world, and it's a biodiversity hotspot, home to lots of species that don't exist anywhere else. And what goes into rivers will eventually come into the ocean. So you have this connection between what's happening up in the rainforest and what's happening at sea. So we were looking at coloured dissolved organic matter. So coloured material is associated with soil, which is really degraded, and it means that the microbes in the water can very rarely access it or eat it. And what we found was that there was lots more of it coming from agricultural settings than there was from forested settings, which means they can't remineralize it into carbon dioxide. And when that type of material gets into the ocean, especially the coastal ocean, the color can decrease the amount of light that can reach the bottom. So when you've got valuable species like seagrass, corals, and other photosynthesizing organisms that need the light, a lot of this material getting into the coastal zone can start to have a really negative impact. So the next steps of the research are to go out there and try and understand if the amount of material and the amount of shading is actually important and if it's having any real effect. But this is an important first step. The marine economy, like, you know, tourism and fisheries, is a really vital way of making money for a huge chunk of the population. So it's not that we don't want agriculture to happen, it's just about finding the evidence to show if it needs to be done in certain ways. I think that the biggest challenges that are facing our coastal zones ultimately start on land, and that we need to be able to work interdisciplinary across land and ocean. And that means working with a lot of different organizations. So we worked with the British Geological Survey for their expertise on, you know, soil materials and different carbon measurements. We worked with the Centre for Ecology and Hydrology because they are excellent at rivers and hydrology and doing mapping. We worked with the modellers at the Oceanography Centre in Liverpool because that's what they do. And then you have the oceanographers at NOC who were learning to do stuff on land the same as we do in the ocean. And it's having these studies with as many people pulling together to try and find the answers is quite critical. The ocean takes in about 40% of the carbon dioxide that we put into the atmosphere. So I think that getting people to interact more with our oceans, especially the coastal zone, and understanding the sort of the effect and the influence they can have over them is really important.
Ongoing research requires innovative thinking to enable scientists to access vital data deep below the sea. New technology being developed at the University of Southampton could perform an important role in that search for answers and unlock new possibilities for future underwater exploration.
There's just so much potential for autonomous systems underwater, and the activities we have in the ocean are just increasing.
Maritime engineering student Thierry Boujard has developed a robot that demonstrates the benefits of using resonance for underwater propulsion. The lightweight design is modelled on nature's most efficient marine animals and has the potential to assist with sensitive ocean research.
I really got into this idea of continuous and autonomous sampling of the oceans, where they basically were describing that since they introduced robotic systems, they were able to increase the quantity of data like tenfold.
I've been working on kind of biologically inspired propulsion for a long time. And a lot of that has to do with flippers or wings or things like that, which can have benefits over regular propellers and rudders. For this project is kind of the pulsing jet, like a jellyfish or octopus or a squid. When you look at underwater vehicles, the ones that don't do anything except for going in a straight line, they have very good cost of transport. So, for instance, Bodie McBoatface is a really advanced research vessel down at NOC, and it's also very big. And it also has an excellently low cost of transport, but it also can't do anything other than go in a straight line. By adopting this more flexible, dynamic approach, we're going to also be able to have this sort of thing move around and be controllable without getting 100 times more costly. That things will stay efficient. For its size, it's as good as Bodie McBoatface.
We searched for, you know, similar ideas in fluid mechanics.
There's been some biologists that say jellyfish kind of bell probably had some kind of resonant. And there were a couple of simulations that were done that sort of indicated that that might be the case. But as far as robotic applications, there really hadn't been anything that took advantage of this yet. The goal of it would be to get it to be pretty autonomous.
I think having something that is more efficient, more biologically compatible, and just in general, much cooler, for me, it's very motivating, and I think it really deserves to go further.
Research is key to understanding the survival of our oceans, and our scientific community is leading the way, challenging our preconceptions of the natural world, both blue and green.
People think of the rainforests and the temperate forest as almost being like the life support system, you know, the lungs of the planet. But actually the ocean is the other half of that. You know, the ocean also takes in a huge amount of carbon dioxide and does produce some oxygen as well. So if you're cutting down trees, which are the lungs, and then you're damaging the ability of the ocean to take up carbon dioxide, or just damaging the ocean in general, then you're kind of hitting it from two fronts. So understanding how these two things interact is really important.
Inventing new approaches to underwater research that excites and enlightens us.
You don't really want a torpedo in those situations. You want something that's kind of more friendly, and if it bounces into something, it's no big deal. Having something that's kind of soft and flexible seems like a better technology for those sorts of applications.
But we all have a part to play in protecting the oceans by working together as a global community to adjust the balance between human and ocean survival.
Humans need to live and humans need to prosper and to have, you know, food and well-being and an income. So finding ways that we can do this so that everybody wins rather than everybody loses is kind of, I think, a big part of what scientists should be doing and can be doing to help.
And a deeper understanding of our impact to life below the surface.
Scientists and engineers putting together these biologically inspired robotic vehicles is a great way of introducing these ideas to the public in general too, and the effects that humans have on the oceans.
Inspiring and empowering a generation of young voices through education and beyond is the key to protecting our oceans and ensuring a sustainable future for our blue planet. On World Oceans Day, we have a unique opportunity to rise to this challenge and restore the natural world on which we depend.